Really happy to be here today. It wasn't a bad drive, just about an hour and 40 minutes from. It would have been easier a few years back because I live right across your old campus. So if it had been a few years back, I would have walked right across the road. So today I wanted to talk about many things. It is also partly I'm trying to clear my head, right? I'll try to talk about our business, about the industry, as well as the socio-economic factors that affect the community that I come from or the place that I come from. I come from a place called Ambur. Anyone has heard of Ambur? What is it famous for? Right. Biryani is what it's most famous for, but the other thing that it is famous for is leather and footwear. The leather and footwear industry goes back to the early 1900s. You know, it was in 1920 that the leather industry started in Ambur. And it has always been an export-driven community in the sense that they were traders and they were exporting dry skins and salted skins to England because of the proximity to the port and because near the forests you could get this vegetable extract that you could use for tanning the leather. That slowly So that slowly actually created a cluster in Ambur, an industrial cluster, where people started investing in tanneries. The British would come in. I have photos at my house of British clients visiting Ambur in 1925. They would come like it was a safari. I mean, there would be 20 of them. They'd come, they'd set up in tents. Used to be very interesting how to look at it. Today the business is a third generation business. We have 27,000 employees, 95% of whom are women. We make 15 million shoes and 24 million square feet of leather. I just wanted to put this up to tell you how the Ambur cluster developed. It started off in the 1920s and it has had several iterations since. So it was originally a cluster for leather, then it went to become a cluster for finished leather, then it went to become a cluster for shoe components, and now finally it's a cluster for footwear, but sadly we are in a decline stage. We are not in the growth stage. In the last few years, the industry in Ambur has been declining, and that's also something that I'm worried about, and I'd like to ask your inputs at the end of the presentation. Ambur, you'll find that they make all the components that go into a shoe. In a shoe, there are over 110 components in a shoe, right from the lace to the eyelet to various parts. And all these parts are made in and around Ambur by all these small industries that now survive because of this industry. What it has done to Ambur is this, right? Those are early pictures of Ambur to where Ambur has gone to today. Those are the shoe factory pictures today to where it was before. Part of the question, part of the dilemma is this globalization has done a lot to Ambur and it has brought increased prosperity, higher income, better employment, better education, and we see both, right? Part of that, the other side is the pollution. It has brought pollution, it has brought inequality, and this is also Ambur, and I worry about the environmental degradation that has happened around, the rising costs, and the pressure on basic social services that we have over there. With that it comes is rising income inequality. I mean, that's in Ambur as well. Polo ground in Ambur, people playing polo, and then you have you can't even get a proper cricket field because they can't afford to get a cricket field. So that is again another, how long is that sustainable? That's not very sustainable if this is the way it's going to go. The income inequality is increasing, and I've seen it increase since my childhood. So we're living in two worlds, a vicious cycle and a virtuous cycle. Two different parts of the community living in two different ways. So the rich are getting richer, the poor are getting poorer. And I like this quote from Thomas Piketty. When the rate of return on capital exceeds the growth rate of the economy, then it logically follows that inherited wealth grows faster than output and income. And he says it's almost inevitable that inherited wealth will dominate wealth amassed from a lifetime's labor by a wide margin. That's disturbing. That's disturbing, you know. That says that clearly that some have an edge because you were born with that inherited wealth, or you had that, you are lucky to have that capital to start with. And it says the concentration of capital will attain extremely high levels, and levels potentially incompatible with meritocratic values and principles of social justice. So what does that mean? And here are some examples. You know, some of my research, I found that 69 of the largest 100 economies are actually companies. They're not countries. I mean, can you believe that? That actually you have, if you were to rate them, you'd have like United States of America, you'd have then China, and then you'd have Apple, and then you'd have, you know, GM, and then you'd have France, and then Italy. So 69% of the economies in the world are actually private companies, I mean, are corporates. So, and the richest 1% own close to 50% of the world's wealth. And on the other hand, you have chronic propensity to grow slowly. Governments are not having the income or generating the income. So local governments are unable to maintain or address social issues, or in some cases provide basic social services, which we all can see outside, right? All you need to do is go down the road and see that basic social services are not being provided. And if you come to Ambur, you know, the municipal services are bad, the waterworks doesn't work, we have various other issues. So I use Ambur as an example. So the question is, do corporates have a moral responsibility to do more? If I take Milton Friedman's guidance, then he says there's only one social responsibility of business, to use its resources and engage in activities designed to increase its profit. So do you follow Milton Friedman, or do you follow Carroll's social, corporate social responsibility pyramid, where he says business has a responsibility to integrate social demands, as corporates depend on society for their continuity, growth, and even existence? So this is kind of a dilemma, and you're trying to say, do I not? This is something that I found, you know, and I find very interesting, is Professor Michael Porter's belief that there is somewhere in between, there is a hybrid option as well. You can do good and be profitable. You don't have to only stick to either profits or being good, and because only if you're only doing good and investing and not looking after sustainability of your margin, then you're not going to survive. So Professor Porter says there is a fundamental synergy, and creating social value and economic value simultaneously is real capitalism. And corporates have the required resources and scalability to resolve global issues. Now, if you think back to the earlier slide, where 69 of the corporate largest economies in the world are corporates, who do you think is better suited today to deal with the social challenges? It's really the responsibility of the corporates to start to up the game, to step up and say, we need to take responsibility to bring about the change. So, a little bit about us. You know, we want to be the most preferred, diversified, adaptive, and socially responsible footwear manufacturer. These are the values. The values are what we tell our management, that as long as it, whatever action you do, as long as it fits those five values, you're free to decide by yourself. You don't need guidance from top management. Every single employee is empowered with those values, and you can take a decision. So I was telling the dean earlier that one of the things we do is I share my telephone number with all the 27,000 employees. So they have access to call me anytime they want. And you would imagine if that many people have your cell phone, and that's, you know, they know that at any point of time, if the water is not cold in the cooler, then they can pick up the phone and call the MD, right? But you'd be surprised, I get maybe 2 calls a month. And those calls are absolutely something worth addressing, needs my immediate attention. And I'm so proud of the fact that they use it so responsibly and don't abuse that. So Farida's philanthropy and CSR, you know, we take care of, we believe in women's empowerment, environmental stability, sustainability and community well-being. These are the things that we aspire to. And you may, it might be hard to read, but I'll just tell you a few things that we do. We don't have unions. We don't have any of these national unions. We've had every single union try to enter us. You know, political unions, PMK, everyone. We've had Anbumani sit outside our gate for hours together trying to create a union. But our workers have refused to join. They're, argument has been, why do we need you? We've got his number, if you want we'll call him and ask him for something. We don't need you to represent us to take our message over to him. And why does that, how does that happen is when you take the responsibility of your workers' health, happiness and safety, we take these things really seriously. There are many things we do, you know, for example, we believe in last mile safety. So every worker, by the time they've got to text us when they reach home, so that we know everyone's reached home safely, because our, we work shifts 6 to 2 and 2 to 10. And we believe that until the last worker has not texted us back that they've gotten home, our management, HR department doesn't leave the factory. In terms of one of the numbers here that I'm very proud of is, I'll show you that a little later as well, it's what's called the GER ratio. When we talk to our workers, we ask them, what's the most important thing for you? What do you think a worker, when you ask them, what's the most important thing? And I do this every month, I sit with the workers. Once a month, I talk to them. And once a month, they talk to me. So I don't open my mouth, I just sit down. It's a, you know, we get about 100 workers, random, come in, and I take notes. They get up and talk about whatever their complaints are and whatever. So we ask them, what do you want? What can we do for you? The most important thing for them is their children and the welfare of their children. That's their number one priority. So we started taking that really seriously. We started saying, how many of you actually have, you know, we have all the kids of our workers in our data file. We track their grades. We make sure that every one of them passes out of school. We give them free tuition. And we make sure that they go on from high school to college. Now, the Indian, the average Indian GER, it's called the gross enrollment ratio, is 27% for India. It's 48% for Tamil Nadu, and it's 95% for Farida. You know that of our employees, kids go to college, and that comes with counseling. It's a lot of counseling because at that, in an economically weaker section, you're looking at your kids and saying, as soon as they finish college, the high school, they can earn money. Go get to work and earn money. So if you're really in need of financial assistance, then you want to push your kids to work. So to convince those parents to say, no, hold on, another 2 years, or another 3 years, and those kids will bring you far more money, it takes a lot of counseling. And we've been able to achieve 95% of our employees now send their kids on to college. We hold a fair in our factory. Over 100 schools come, colleges come to the fair, and we've expanded their mind to think that it's not only BCom and BE and whatever, but there's nursing and there's ITIs and many other things that their kids could actually study to earn more money. We rate or constantly take ratings on how happy our employees are with us. So, I mean, it's kind of the point I'm trying to make is, like, Farida's role is partly a quasi-public role in that small community. I mean, it's a small town, it's about 180,000 people in Ambu, but our role is, we take care of all the polio drops. 100% of the town is covered by us. We take care of all the, we do eye cams for the whole town. It's like fully engaged. One of the things we do is we invite, we believe in a community outreach program where we invite the police commissioner and the whole police department people to come and talk to our employees, and they can write their complaints not necessarily at the police station but at the factory. That makes it so much easier because it's very unlikely that they would actually go to the police station to file a complaint, but giving them the possibility empowers them. So what next, right? So I was talking earlier, you've got philanthropy and CSR, but philanthropy is not sustainable. CSR is sustainable as long as the company survives. What next is what Porter's concept of creating shared value, and this is something we are going to experiment on. One of the things I do also as part of, I was telling you earlier that Mr. Narasimhan, our coach, made us do is, we had a coach, our company has a coach, a management guru called Mr. Narasimhan. From TBS. So he asked me, he said, how well do you know your workers? And I said, I talk to them now fairly regularly. He said, no, how well do you really know them? Maybe one or two by name like that. But he said, why don't you get to know them better? I said, okay, what do you mean? Said, visit them at home. Okay, so now I have to visit, I mean, as per Mr. Narasimhan's requirement. I visit at least 15 workers in their house every month. Okay? Now, I cannot tell you how much that's changed me because it's had a major impact on my approach and my outlook at my own, workers, community. Because when you go to their house, and it is like that, 100 square feet room, kids, family, there's bedroom, kitchen, everything is in there. And when that worker really says, I need that raise, it puts it in perspective. You know that money is genuinely needed, and you start to think about it. So that physically visiting, seeing, having a cup of tea, the expense that they go through when they know that they're managing director, MD is visiting them, shocks me. They know I like oranges, they'll buy oranges. They'll get a photographer for the day. They'll stop their husband to go to work because they'll say, my MD is coming. They'll lose their pay, but they'll sacrifice on that just for that, just for being present on that day. So this was a project that I came up with and then reached out to another friend of mine, and I said, yeah, there might be something here that we could do. And this whole thing about affordable housing, now with the PM scheme, PMRY, there's government incentives for doing affordable housing as well. So we said, okay, is there something we can do to improve the living reality that our workers are in? And we said, okay, we can come up with a project. But it needs to be, it can't be a CSR, it can't be a philanthropy, it's got to be a business project. So we brought in a team of people from one of the most famous research companies from Mumbai, 15 people came in from Mumbai and shadowed our workers for about 3 weeks, which means getting up in the morning till night, following them, understanding their pattern, what do they eat, where do they store their stuff, how do they spend their time, just to understand what their living reality is. And then using that information, we then created what we call this project, called the Samya Equality Project. And this project is designed by a very famous architect called Mr. Ashok Lal in Delhi. He does housing for Tata Housing, and very, very famous. We are glad to have him. He spent a week in Ambur as well with us to understand the requirements. The target is 7 lakh rupees per apartment, and to build 1,000 apartments, each one 325 square feet, with an EMI of 2,500 rupees. This is affordable because our employees make about 10,000 rupees a month, and a project payback at 10%. In 3 years. Now, you know what the risks are, the challenges were when I took this project over, was the people who found it to, the financing and my partners. The challenge is resisting the temptation to stop with 10% profit. Because 7 lakhs, we could sell that for 15. There is demand at that for that quality and for that the facilities and the what we offer in this place. We believe that people will, we could easily demand and make much more money, 30-40% margin on this. But to stop, the ability to be able to stop yourself and say, no, we're going to stop at 10%, we're going to charge. But then the other challenge is to whether they'll sell it, and then they'll sell it and then go back to living in the same urban slums that we have. So that is, then the other risks are, are we getting too involved in this? Are there risks in, the challenge was currently everyone's living in segregation, there's caste, there's communal segregation. Now, in this housing, how do you do it? Do you bring everyone together? What happens if it doesn't work out? Will it backfire on the company? Will it be seen as something the company did that will then cause us to lose our own business? What if there's a riot tomorrow in Ambur and the factory gets burned down because we started a community where ended up being a hotbed for problems tomorrow? Because, these are challenges that I sometimes debate with myself, and I say, am I pushing too much? Should I really get involved in this? Don't have an answer, but I'm still moving forward, right? Price is only one of the factors, and that's what we realize. And we recognize that we have to respect their dignity. We can't push too much and get them to all change overnight, to how we want them to live. This is something that I've asked myself, can Farida make an impact? And these are certain things. And we found that, within our compound, with the number of workers that we have, we can make an impact. And if we can make an impact there, that's good enough for now, right? That makes an impact on the whole community. And if that can then grow to being a larger, that can have positive impacts, overflow to the whole town. We know there are some numbers here, like the GR ratio I told you about. Anyone who's not passed high school in our workforce, we make them pre-write exams, and we make sure we give them tuitions and make sure they're all high school pass. We ask them, what do you want to learn? They all want to learn spoken English. So we give them spoken English classes at the factory. Talking to them about institutional birth, the advantages of that, various things. There are many other things we still don't know, but if we do this housing project, we would have more confidently say that we've given our people, better drinking water, better, households with toilets. We can bring a positive impact to the community. So, calling ourselves a social, trying to tell my team and my management that don't look at yourself as a shoe factory, but as a social impact enterprise, that we just happen to make shoes, but our real purpose is to bring about change in and around us. And there we learned that just good intent and charity, a lot of people do that, is insufficient. It needs all three, philanthropy, CSR and CSV, which is creating shared value, an equal commitment to both long-term profitability and sustainability. If you give up your long-term profitability just because you want to be a good person, you know, you're not going to continue this for too long. And lastly, because businesses that truly change the world for the better are the ones that will last, so we believe that's why we should be doing it and not just do it because of any other reason. We want to survive, and we believe doing good will keep us alive for the longer period. Thank you very much.
So it's time for you to shoot your questions.
In the housing project that you have taken, is there any government assistance that you have been getting?
There's a government subsidy is there for the workers who take the loan, you know, because they'll get a loan on this. The banks have to give them subsidized interest rate loans, and they are eligible for it. Because these workers are now employed with us, it's much easier for the bank to do it as well. So that's the benefit they'll get. We don't get anything, but they'll get the benefit too. Yes.
Sir, how significant is the pre and post analysis of the changes which you have made in the social fabric of these people? How it has affected the productivity and efficiency overall?
Good question. A happy worker is more productive. A happy worker comes to work every day. An unhappy worker doesn't. If I have 7%, 8% absenteeism, my productivity in the factory goes down. If I have 2% absenteeism, so why do you even have that? So we study absenteeism extremely, it's very important indicator of a worker's happiness is how we see it. So when we see absenteeism in a line and we break it down by, we have 46 lines in the factory. We break it down by the line. And the responsibility of absenteeism is with the line supervisor. If a line has a higher degree of absenteeism, the supervisor gets penalized. He has to be able to understand what the challenges are, why the worker is not coming, positive investments like in making their lives better, whether it's the, if you see, you know, it's usually because the kids were not well. So we have a doctor full time in our factory. So you can bring your kids free of cost, get medical help, medicine is given free of cost. So now that's not a reason. We have a creche inside which is world class with a nurse full time. So you can bring your sick child and the child can be at the factory if necessary, taken care of, better care than maybe at home. So the answers that we see, you know, immediately relates to an economic benefit as well in doing all those social causes.
Yes.
Thank you,
sir. So first, thank you so much for this opportunity. Sir, in the beginning you told that the globalization did wonders to Angur, but now it is declining. The same trend we have seen like with the Bangladesh weavers, what did the industrialization did with them. So the customization that these centers, small centers in the conventional era provided, what is the competition you faced while sustaining your industry from the outer players, and what is the trade-off that you need to find regarding this?
See, good. I mean, these are the questions I'm asking myself, so glad you're asking this. My understanding is that the reason why we are losing out, and due to globalization, it's better integration, is lack of innovation. What we are now seeing in Ambur is, and the larger companies are getting bigger, but the mid-sized companies are all not able to keep up with this trend in globalization. The speed of response. Today, we make shoes for Zara, right? The Zara client today wants a shoe in their, a new shoe in the shop every 6 weeks. The normal, like a Bata, I also make shoes for Bata. Bata takes, says, we want new shoe every 6 months. Zara wants a new shoe in the shop every 6 weeks. It's completely different management skill, different investment, infrastructure, mindset, everything to be able to cater to a Zara versus catering to a Bata. And whoever doesn't change, doesn't survive. And that's what we are seeing right now in our industry, that people are not able to switch over. But the switch over, in fairness, is not easy. It requires a lot of investment into the business as well, capital investment in modernization of machinery, in vertical integration of components, all that. So some of the mid-sized companies don't have the, those resources to invest, and they are losing out because of that. No, not really, because we are contract manufacturers, you know, and there is enough scope to grow in this category. To launch a brand and to manage a brand is a completely different skill set. We are good at manufacturing. We are not necessarily good at marketing to consumer, B2C. So I believe for us, we will grow, continue to grow in subcontracting, but if there is a good brand to be bought that, that Farida can invest in but not necessarily manage, we will consider that.
So what motivated you to focus on employees, more on employees and social responsibility?
Why? Because, you know, today is, I'll ask you, having 27,000 employees is an asset or a liability? What is it? How many think it's a liability? Imagine, you know, when I have, at the end of the month, on the 30th of every month, when I have to make that check out for the salaries, if I don't make that check fully, you can imagine what happens, right? I fear that day, because I have to keep running as fast as I can and keep growing and keep getting the business to make sure that I keep them all gainfully employed. And at the rate at which we grow, I shudder sometimes and say, okay, this 27,000, what if it becomes 40,000? Will we be able to handle it? If at that point I'm not able to, you know, if the business changes, I'm not able to get my factories full, and I can't, because in India it's not easy to just lay off workers. You can't just say, okay, today we don't have work, everyone go home. You can't. You still have to cough up at the end of the month. So I, you know, I ask myself, is it an asset or is it a liability? You know? And I think we're thinking it's an asset as of today. We are conscious that it can become a liability also.
So there's all the social schemes which are guaranteed to your workers and all, is it extended to your suppliers?
No, we don't, not yet. We don't. And good question. I think there's so much more we can do with our current employees itself. But you know what's happening is our clients are becoming very, very conscious of all that we do, and they are starting to require this from all their suppliers. So they'll set our practices as a benchmark for our competitor and say, you also should do this. And there, you either can do it for face value, or you can believe in it and do it really. You know, you can get a crash looking good but no kids in the room because you just don't really want to have that headache of having kids come in and go and stuff. Or you can really invest and do the right thing. So I think this will also become a competitive advantage in the longer run.
One last question, is there any plans to go public?
Maybe in the, after a few years, nothing right now. We you know, the only reason why you would want to go public is to raise capital, right? We are faced with a situation now where if we don't keep growing, we will be out of the market. In a global scale, Farida, the largest Indian company in footwear, is a small company by Chinese standards. The largest Chinese footwear company makes one single largest Chinese company makes more than all of India put together. There are 12 Chinese companies that do more than all of India put together. So, you know, the scale is huge. If we want to survive, we have to grow significantly. And if we want to grow like that, I think we have to reach out to the capital market.
Like, you are saying business is labor intensive, it's based on labor, so, but as technological development increases, labor requirement reduces. Then how is this Farida is thinking about to
use that skill for their labor skill development for their labors? Very good question. Currently, when the shoes that you wear, 110 people touch it before it gets put into the box. Okay, there's like so many stages of labor. The sports shoes that you wear, like a Nike or an Adidas, instead of 110, it's 40. Because automation has replaced many of those. So, you know, you can look at it two ways. Again, you can reskill your people and you have that huge base that you can use to grow fast of workers, if you can provide it, you can reskill them, and which is not a very difficult thing. So we are conscious of that. Like, the new trend in footwear is less labor, more automation. So we are, the new factories that we are putting are all based on the new modernized concept. For example, a simple thing, a stitcher in our factory stitches sitting down. They are used to sit down and stitch. In the new manufacturing efficiency, lean cell manufacturing concept, workers are not meant to sit down. To try to get our workers who have been sitting and stitching for 30 years or 20 years to now tell them that now you cannot stitch sitting down, you've got to stand and stitch because you want to be able to move in different directions depending on how the work is, takes a lot of counseling. A lot of constant and mindset change and stuff, which we are doing.
Sir, as China moves more and more to high value, high profitable manufacturing, unfortunately that space that is given away by China is taken over by countries like Bangladesh, and India is somehow lagging behind. So how the industrial community and how the government can do something to fill in that gap that is unfortunately being taken over by countries like Bangladesh?
You know, the answer for that is like Anand's book, Can India Grow? gives the answer for that, where it says clearly that small is not beautiful, right? And what are the reasons why, what is holding India back in thinking in the previous, you know, our policy has constantly been for the MSMEs, saying that small is good and has favored that. And with a completely different outset, the government has already started, and I was telling over lunch that already the government has opened up policy to be more large scale friendly. So there's nothing the government needs to do. Now it's the entrepreneurs in India who need to change and accept that the policies have changed. We can think in a much larger scale and follow the examples of what Reliance have done, who have thought big and tried to do that. India, we are definitely capable of doing it, and we should look for that.
I have a few questions of my own. How many months or years since you moved to Ethiopia? What is the stark difference, opinion you find, between the productivity and the workers there versus in other places you operated, including in India and Bangladesh, etc.?
It's been 6 years we are in Ethiopia, and it's one of our most profitable businesses. Exactly similar challenges as in India, with worker mindset, you know, cultural changes, challenges. Today, productivity is higher in Ethiopia for us than in India, because I think we learned many more things in India, which we did not make the same mistakes when we started Ethiopia. So we were able to, today we achieve better efficiencies in Ethiopia. Not to say that India can't do it, it's just that India is lagging behind now. Bangladesh goes on stream for us, the factory will go on stream in April. So again, we hope that it will be better than India, because all the lessons we learned here, we'll be able to adopt that. The new Indian factories, however, that we are opening, mm-hmm. those are much higher in productivity as well.
What's the reason behind having 95% women workforce? Is there a
problem? Because they were all not working before. We wanted labor. The men were all employed already in the tanneries, in the leather factories. And we said, we could find all this latent labor sitting idle. So when we started the first factory in Ambur with women workforce, we had a major issue with the parda problem. You know, the women in the refused to come to work because they said, "Nay, you can't come in front of men. They have to wear the burqa and stuff." Because Ambur is 45% Muslim. So the first factory, I have photos, have got pardas in the factory. So right in the center of the factory, there's a parda, and the women used to work on this side and the men were on this side. And you couldn't converse with, I have photos of the supervisor talking behind the parda and telling the worker, this is what has to be done, without having it. After some time, the practicality of it came forward and people threw the parda down and started working on it. So the women was because they were there, and we thought that was an opportunity for us. Second, we operate shifts, and it's easier for the women. We get all the married women come in the second shift, and most of the unmarried women come in the first shift. And now they insist. When we started a new factory, we wanted to start first with a general shift. We couldn't hire workers for that factory because people said, you know, we want the shift system, you know, because it's so convenient for us to work and earn, you know, stay home and do what we have to, plus we can get a job that earns money.
Sir, Ambur has abundance of raw materials like leather. So, do you have any plans for a product, getting into new product mix, like making leather vests, like high design, and getting into making seat covers for various big brands like BMW or DM?
Ambur doesn't have any raw material. There's no raw material in Ambur. Ambur is only a processing center. Every single skin in Ambur comes from West Bengal, Rajasthan. All comes from the north. And I think the way out for this decline that I'm saying the cluster is doing, is experiencing, is product diversification. And it has to happen. You know, we need new product categories to come. Right now it's too dependent on footwear, and that's not good. So it's not yet happened. There are one or two glove factories, leather gloves factories that have come up, but I think in the next few years we will see more and more product diversification happen, because that's definitely a better market than what footwear is today. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yes.
Sir told us in the introduction that after so long you went back to university in 2017. How, sir? Why?
I went back because I was looking for answers. I graduated 1994 MBA and full of dreams to change the world and said and got to work, and then reality hit me, and it took 20 years of understanding that this is not so easy to change the world. Today, after all those years, I feel if I understand this better, I can actually bring an impact to at least my area, which is, let's say, Ambur is about, like I said, at least that area I can bring an impact and understand what the consequences of my actions can be, right? And I went back to school just for that. I chose to go back to Fletcher School of Diplomacy because they had a program on development economics, and to understand what the cause and effect of those can be, and trying to understand that better. That's why I went back. I'm glad I did. I come back today. I still don't necessarily have an answer, but I think I understand a little bit.
Sir, in a country like India, we know that apparel products such as shoe is seasonal. So how do we maintain the profitability of the business from an operational perspective?
We don't sell anything in India. It's 100% export business. So shoes are worn throughout the year. Only the change is boots to regular shoes. So we make boots for winter and shoes for summer in our factories. To give you an idea, the problem is like our workers in the factory in Amput don't understand boots, don't understand shoes, they don't wear it. So we did an experiment in one of the shoes, we put the heel in front instead of the back, and it got packed. Mm-hmm. And that tells you that if the worker doesn't understand it, appreciate it, that's what you need to do now, to teach them that. Because what do you do? If it's a product you're making that you don't wear, you can't relate to, it's a challenge, right? So anyway, the point is we are luckily not so affected by seasonality because one, we change product. Second, we change markets as well. So during winters in Europe, we sell in Australia also. So there it's summer. It's summer in South America. So we sell in those markets the same product.
I have one question. Sir, you have 95% of your employees were women. So the motivation you have said earlier that why you have employed women. So what could be a business reason for employing women? Like from your observations, you have seen them working so much. So if you have to tell someone that you should employ women, so what could be the business reasons behind it?
I don't know if it's politically right, the business reasons to say, but in terms of industrial relations, I'll give you one good example, a good reason, right? When we did this study from the research company from Mumbai that came and did a shadow to our workers for 3 weeks, it really was an eye-opener for us on how that money was used, their income, how they used their income, compared to when they shadowed the male workers and they shadowed the female workers, how they spent the spending patterns of the male versus female was completely different for us. The investment, it was so cautiously invested, the women workers used every single rupee cautiously in their kids' education, they saved more money, whereas the men spent it on alcohol, it was wasted, a lot of it was on discretionary income, wasted on non-productive things. So a person who values that money works far better, is more committed to your work, is not interested in getting in doing unions and politics and problems, which men workers tend to get easily swayed by, if Anbumani PMK comes and says, I'll get you 50% raise from the factory, join me. The men are more likely to go with him than the women.
Sir, Would you like to comment on the upcoming Lok Sabha elections? The moment you want and what policies you want them to implement for your betterment of your industry?
No, I'll tell you one thing. As a businessman, the current government has been very proactive. Okay, because it took decisions. It's taking decisions and it is open to listen to what the industry wants. And compared to the previous government, I would say significant movement in commerce, in policies and receptive to businessmen's demands. So that much I can say that has been positive. So that's...
Just the last couple of questions, maybe.
Yes. The question is related to the project that you are going to start, where we are in the process of starting. What is the retention ratio of the workers, specifically the women workers? Why I am asking this question is, what is the ratio of unmarried and married women? Because married women face a lot of problems from their families or from their husband when it comes to working in the factory. When once the women start working as a worker in a factory, their husband stops working. So how these problems are catered to from your organization?
You know, we did a study afterwards when we did all this study about socio-economic impact and stuff. We brought Madras School of Social Studies to do a research on our factory, on the community. When the report came out and I presented it to my board said, okay, thank you, lock it up and forget about it. Because the report, basically the research showed that in Ambur, after the shoe factories have come in, love marriages have increased by 5 times. Alcoholism among men has shot up to 3 times. Domestic abuse, violence from men versus against their wives, and has increased dramatically. So huge changes had happened in the society because the women had started earning money. I mean, it had caused many problems with, you know, ego problems. The man doesn't feel like he gets the respect. The women, now if you come and see the factory, outside the factory or outside the schools in Ambur, it's the men who are picking up the kids, the men who are bringing the lunch and dinner for the workers, and the women are working. So this is not easy in our society, and this takes a lot of counseling. There are women who we offer promotion to who turn it down and say, no, I don't want to, I'm happy, I want to continue working. If I get a promotion and I earn more, my husband will tell me to stop working. So I'd rather just continue here like this. So we teach self-defense classes in our factory to workers. Self-defense in the sense not to beat up their husband, but to protect themselves. If they are, you know, victims of domestic abuse, how do you protect yourself? And when you get to talk about these things, you hear back from them what they are suffering, because in our culture we don't talk about the problems we face. It's all hushed up. Everyone hushes it up. So.
Thank you so much for your wonderful participation. I have to end with one last question from my side. These are all, a good number of them are graduating in a month's time, of course, which you did about 30 years ago. So what would be the single most important piece of message or advice from your side to this graduating students? Quite a few of them will be stepping into the corporate world in a month's time.
Might sound a bit idealistic, but I found that chasing money is not necessarily the answer, right? Money will follow through. Chase a purpose. Chase a purpose. Money follows. It gives a meaning to your life. It has. It's much, much more meaningful when you chase a purpose, and you've got to find what your purpose is. But a lot of us chase material things. But I think when you chase a whatever it is, and that purpose can be learning, that purpose can be, you know, whatever brings you happiness. But I found that having a greater purpose is much more meaningful than chasing the money.
Let us put our hands together. It's such a wonderful opportunity for all of us to hear from someone. First of all, in Kriya University, we talk about learning to learn. And he has done that, continuously sort of re-questioning, re-examining what he learned and going back to school, and also showing that the 1970, if I'm not mistaken, 1970 New Yorker article by Michael Friedman, it's 1970 article. Interestingly, towards his last days, not so much about this particular aspect of the social purpose of business, when Milton Friedman was questioned about his monetary economics, he did say that today he wouldn't be pushing it as strongly as he did when he was younger. Maybe if this question also was posed to him,
probably,
I don't know whether he would have revised himself about the social purpose of business. But it is being questioned, and as we speak, the Democratic Party has a new Green New Deal, GND as they call it, etc. So all these things are coming back. So if you don't do it yourself voluntarily, then the social and political evolution will force you to adopt these things, because naturally, unless there is a check and balance, you tend to overreach and become excessively capitalistic. So it is just as well that you embrace it, and it shows that it is not a win-lose situation. It is indeed a win-win situation. And as he said, finally, the wonderful words, chase your purpose and the money will follow. So I think this is, I think those of you who were here have been exceptionally lucky to listen to his talk and his message. I hope you will reflect on it and tell your friends who missed it as to what they missed. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Pleasurable formality. On behalf of all of my student friends and my colleagues, it is my pleasure to thank him for his time and for the effort he made to come and share his thoughts and questions, etc. A small token of appreciation and thanks from our side.
Thank you all. Have a nice afternoon.
Thank you.